Hello, this is Stephen Van Kampen-Lewis again. It is April 28th. As far as I know, my kids are asleep, taking a nap. So I figure I might as well film another episode here while I have a few minutes. And today I want to talk to you a little bit more about Catasetum growing and more specifically some advanced Catasetum topics. And when I say advanced topics, it's more advanced techniques. So if you are just getting into Catasetums, these are not necessarily things that will be geared towards you. I encourage everybody who is just getting into this group to go to Fred Clark's website at Sunset Valley Orchids and look up Catasetinae culture. He's got a great page and it talks quite a bit about what you should and shouldn't do in most situations for this group, and that's sort of, you know, they like lots of fertilizer during the growing period, lots of light, lots of water, and then no water at all for, you know, maybe half the year. And I encourage everyone to sort of to follow along with that mantra until it doesn't work, or at least until you've grown them for long enough that you have a pretty good idea of when you can start playing with your growing techniques. One of the things that I want to talk to you about is early watering and some other things. But before I jump into that, the first video I made was the PET method, and we repotted a Cloacetum Dragon's Gem, Dragon's Treasure Cadrona. The Cadrona is the clonal name. And I think I filmed that video in February. It's now, like I said, April 28th. And yeah, you can see, if you remember, I repotted this in this Costco biscotti deal. But you can see we've got massive new growth in the roots. We've got a massive new growth up here. And one, two, three additional growths. Sort of throughout the area. You can see the roots pretty well here. You can spin them around, you can see a little bit more, but you can really see it on this side. So, you know, I've got my fingers here to show size reference of how large this is. You can see this root is growing out the hole here. I will eventually snap that off. But you can see these roots are at least, you know, probably close to 4 inches long, until you look down here and you realize that they're diving under and into the media. So I don't really know how long these are. And the traditional mantra says 4 inches is when sort of the minimum when you want to start watering. I'm not going to water this for a long time. I might even wait another full month. And if I can get those roots all the way down here and this particular growth this big, you know, and these other smaller growths probably to this same size without shriveling the bulbs, you can see these bulbs. So on these big mature plants, they can really take a lot of drying and it doesn't phase them. There's some shriveling, but I'm very comfortable with where this plant is at. And the more root growth I can get before starting to water, the better. So when we talk about your sort of traditional letting the plant dry out for 6 months, this is sort of a good example. Now, sometimes that doesn't work. Sometimes, even on big, large, mature plants, you know, you can have extensive shriveling. So I haven't watered this one since November, I think, is when I cut the leaves off. This is labeled as Catasetum expansum. It's not. It bloomed out last year as not macrocarpum. I think it's macroglossum. I need to change the label in any case. That reminds me. And so during this winter's sort of dry period, it decided that it was going to put out a new growth. That's this little teeny guy here. I didn't care. I'm not going to water it. And you can see here's one of those old spent bulbs. Just throw that away. But what you'll notice is on the largest, the biggest growth here, you know, the sheath, it looks really thin. You can see the sheath, it sort of looks like baggy clothes on this guy. And I'm going to see if I can peel it back here so you can see a little bit better about the shriveling that I'm talking about. And to be honest, the shriveling on this is not that extensive. It doesn't worry me at all. So this one put out a small new growth during the dormant season over here, and it had to expend a lot of energy to do that. Now you can see it's got a huge root system, just a super happy plant. It's also decided to be extremely ambitious and put out two spikes. This particular spike just decided to abort. Now, when you see something like this, it means that there's probably not enough water. So this plant has put out two spikes and a new growth during the dry season. It hasn't seen water since November. It's now April 28th. The bulbs don't look that shriveled to me. You know, they get quite a bit fatter, but it's not going to die. It's not even going to be hurt. But the fact that it aborted this particular growth means that it probably could use a little water. Now, how do you water without getting the new roots wet? Well, there's a couple ways. Well, first of all, why don't we water for, you know, half the year? There's two reasons. The first reason during the cold months is that you run the risk of rot. So you water these plants, and for whatever reason, they're very susceptible to rot during those colder periods of the year. And the second reason that you don't water, especially as the new growths are getting longer, is when those new roots touch the wet media, they have a tendency to not grow anymore. So let's say your roots are this long, you start to water, and they don't get longer than this. That's bad for the plant. Especially since you can see how extensive these root systems can be. Now this is only one season of growing in here. So they have huge, huge root systems. So if your roots are this long and they're stopping growing, your plant's not going to live for very long, right? So here's a new root. You know, how do I water this? How do I get water to this plant without affecting this root? So the cool thing about the PET method is that I can add water down here. So it's April 28th. We're well past the growing season here in Texas. It's about 90 degrees right now. I am in no way, shape, or form worried about rot, but I am worried about having these new roots stop growing. Now, they haven't reached this water well, so what I did the other day is I added some water to the bottom, so these roots that are sitting in the bottom can slurp up the moisture needed so that hopefully I won't lose this spike too. Now, the good thing about this particular plant is it's one of those ones that seems to spike all year round. It spikes in the spring, as you can see, and I had blooms in the fall too, so, you know, just losing one of these is not huge. I'll still see blooms, probably not as many as I would like. It would have been great to have these two spikes blooming at the same time, but such is life. I also want to mention the fact that I used to live in Hawaii, and specifically I lived in the Big Island, and that's when I started growing the Catasetinae in about 2005 or so, I think. And Jean Monnier, he moved to the Big Island, he retired. You may not know who he is. He is the Fred Clark before Fred Clark. Jean Monnier was the pioneer of this particular group in the 80s and 90s, and he was the owner of Gem Orchids. In fact, those of you who grow Cycnokies may know the name Cycnokies Jean E. Monnier, Jean E. Monnier is Jean Monnier's wife. And yes, there are two people in the same house whose name is Jean Monnier. But in any case, I tracked him down on the Big Island, and I was able to go out to his place and pick his brain a little bit. And he's absolutely convinced that these guys don't necessarily need a dry period if you're able to keep the temperatures above 55 degrees. You know, not long after that, I moved over to Oahu. I lived in Honolulu, and that is not the Big Island. The Big Island is a totally separate island from where Honolulu is at. And in Honolulu, that, or at least on the other side of the island from Honolulu, is where H&R Orchids is. And at that time, they were growing some Catasetinae, especially they were selling Catasetum expansum and some of their hybrids, and a bunch of the Cycnokies. Specifically, I think I got Heron Husseinum, Jean E. Monnier, Bartiorum Cooperi from them. And Roy was telling me, he's like, hey, you know, we don't stop watering. You know, we grow our plants outside all year round. If it rains in December and all the plants are dormant, they're getting wet. And it doesn't really affect them. And, you know, that side of the island doesn't ever get below 55 degrees. So that sort of plays into that. At least what Jean Monnier told me is that, you know, like I said, if temperatures don't go below 55 degrees and they stay warmer than that, you know, some water on the plants is okay. Now again, if you are just growing these guys for the first time this year or last year, I really encourage you to sort of get your beginner techniques down and really understand this group before you start playing with the watering. But I do encourage you to start playing with the watering. There's a gentleman, I'm on Orchid Board. my handle is Isurus79 on Orchid Board. there's a gentleman over there on Orchids. His name is Orchids Are Fun. Him and I disagree on a lot of things, and that's okay, that's great. One of the things that he is doing is he's got a really interesting thread where he's watering plants sort of all winter long, or at least during the early growing phase, and he's having pretty good success. You know, I'm kind of frustrated that some people might put this information out there and, you know, you'll see a beginner saying, oh, well, I can water all year round. It's not really true. He's an advanced grower. He's been doing it for a long time. And, you know, I'm assuming he's keeping his temperatures above 55 degrees. But, so, you know, these rules where you can't water no matter what, it's not necessarily true, as with so many living organisms, reality is a little more nuanced. But, like I said, you know, the tried and true mantra of keeping them dry for 6 months out of the year works very well. I still do that, and I encourage other folks to do it as well. But again, there are exceptions to every rule. Now, this is Catasetum Bella Vista Sangria. It's a semi-complex hybrid. Got expansum and peliotum in the background, so there's a nice little bloom spike here in the spring. But I chopped this one up this fall, and I sold the other half. But the important part is, you know, these bulbs, they're shriveled somewhat, but they're still going. It wouldn't at all surprise me if this spike gets aborted before the flowers come out. So I may add a little water to the bottom here. I don't know that the roots go that far, so it might not work. This is one of those situations where if I saw this, someone else doing this, and they cut the spike off to sort of encourage the plant to grow more, it's probably a fair idea. I'm actually going to let this one go and see if I can get blooms. The blooms on this one are beautiful. I absolutely love it. But again, these are the sort of decisions that each grower has to make for each individual plant. And knowing about these techniques and is really it's a grower's choice, you know. And sometimes your plants are going to die. So you have to accept that. I want to show you one of my imports. This comes from Bella Vista in Brazil. This is Catasetinae Mato Grossoense. And it's a little seedling. It's just adapted to the northern hemisphere. I've had it for about a year and a half, I think, or maybe 2 years actually. But this growth is way up in the air. So what do I do with that? Take this old bulb, rip it off, and throw it away. You know, the more that I look at this, I'm not entirely sure that it's even attached to the other bulb. But in any case, what I'm gonna have to do is repot this. So I'm gonna take this out of the pot, and now when the roots are this long, I really don't like to repot unless I have to, but I think in this case I will have to. and I'll sink this down so that this is just below the moss line. I want those roots to go down into the moss as quickly as possible. The aerial roots like this, especially in my conditions, often will abort when they're too dry in the air for too long. Now, being dry and in the media, for some reason, that's fine. The plant's okay with that typically, and they'll continue to grow roots. But when they're in the air like this, and they're not, in any case, I want these roots to grow. I'm going to repot it, and I'm going to sink it down into the media. Whereas, you know, if you take a Catasetinae and you sink it down into the media, you know, you really run the risk of rot along the rhizome. You don't really have that problem with these guys. Finally, I have a small Catasetum tenebrosum. I got this from a friend here in Texas who sells a lot of these, and it is a smaller seedling. So the smaller seedlings are probably not going to put out 4-inch roots before you can start watering them. I also want to point out the growth is pretty large, but these bulbs are pretty much as shriveled as they will get. You know, there's not much more nutrition in these bulbs. I'm going to pull the sheath off here and see if I can show you any more. You know, it doesn't really look any prettier. You can see these roots are growing this way and then down. So this particular root is probably not quite 4 inches long, but that might be okay. I think if I wait any longer, I run the risk of killing the plant. As I've said in previous videos, I kind of aim for stopping watering in mid-November, and water resumption I like to do for Memorial Day, which is late May. I should know that. I think it's late May. So that's an extensive period of time for no water. And for a little guy like this, or an import that's also a little guy, you know, sometimes the rules are meant to be broken. I think this is going to be the first plant that I water. In fact, I'm probably going to go water it after this video. And those are most of the advanced Catasetum techniques that I can kind of think of off the top of my head. If you have any questions, you know, shoot me a message and I will try to answer it as quickly as I can and hopefully as succinctly as I can. But in any case, talk to you later.